Cool. So let's
Oh,
get going,
let's
right?
get going. Exactly. So we are discovering Neo4j Aura DB free with Michael and myself. As usual, I'll give a quick overview of what's going down today. So we will do a quick recap of what's Neo4j Aura DB free. I will do that in a second. We pick a data set and then we work with that data set. So if you have a data set you'd like us to explore, let us know. If you have anything you find interesting and we thought, okay, this could be good for this session, for this format here on the Mondays where we are live, send it to us. You can reach us. Just put it in chat here if you're watching live. If you watch this on demand later on, you can tweet us on Twitter. You can write us on Discord. You can reach out to us on the community forums. There are many ways.
Middle, yeah.
Exactly. So that's just let us know. Today we picked already a data set, so you don't have to worry about that. We think a little bit about what questions we might ask. What kind of data set do we have? What's interesting about it, and what could be interesting in terms of an application that would run with that data set. Out of these points, we will determine the data model and develop that a little bit, and then load and query. Obviously, that's important, and get the data into Neo4j Aura DB free, and then play with it a little bit. What is Neo4j Aura DB free? So it's the free version of Neo4j Aura DB. So Aura DB is our database as a cloud offering, which we launched almost a year ago, I think. And Aura DB free was just recently announced as publicly available for everybody. Is the free edition of that data graph database as a service offering. So you get a slightly limited edition of Neo4j Enterprise, but you get the full features set basically, the limitation is in terms of nodes and relationships. So you will have to do with 50,000 nodes and 175,000 relationships. You get full access to Neo4j Bloom as well as browser. It's free forever. So that means, unlike Sandbox, which is kind of like what you used to have in terms of new user try out without installing anything, that closed off after 7 days. So the Sandbox, Neo4j RDB free stays with you forever. It's free forever. The only thing that could happen to you is if you don't use it, it's going to be paused. But you can always get it back up again if you use it. But that's only if you don't use it for a couple of days. And then it stops that process for you, but you can always come back and log in again and say, "Hey, I'm using this," and then it's up again. If you want to find out more, you can go to the landing page. I'll post a link in a second. But here we go. Let's dive into it. Today's topic is a consumer complaints database. So I think we had talked about this last time a little bit that we want to look into a here into the session, and I think of we this is one of the top queries, right? That comes up lots of times because it handles the load CSV part of it all, and oftentimes this session still comes up, and it's an old session we have on our YouTube channel, but we thought of, okay, hey, can we modernize this a little bit, and can we bring this on to 2021? So this is
Exactly. That's the idea.
the idea from today. All right. Anything you want to add, Michael?
Two quick things or three quick things. So first of all, hi to everyone else. Hi Mustafa from Austin, Michelle from Brazil, and the person from London. So good to see people from all over the world. And there was a question from Alexei, if APOC and Near Semantics are available in RDB free. So APOC Core or a subset of APOC Core is available on RDB free, not the full version, because the full version has also dependencies on extra libraries that are not available there. And Near Semantics is currently not available on RDB free. But if you're also looking into working on an version of Near Semantics that actually runs outside of the database, and so we'll see if that's something that makes progress. Mm-hmm. And then Harsh had a question. Using a graph database for accounting and invoicing, basically, as you can use graph databases everywhere where you can use a relation database, I think it makes sense. So you can use it there. The only thing that it's probably not as well suited for is if you have to do massive number crunching calculations. So if you want to compute like the what's the average invoice price about over 100 million invoices or something like that, or like at this range. So, I mean, if it's just a million or so, it's not a big deal. But if it's like really number crunching on large data volumes, data warehouse like things, that's probably not as well suited for. But otherwise, for anything up to scale, it's definitely possible to do it as such. And there was one comment that I wanted to make to what you said, Alex, about AuraDB and Aura Enterprise features. AuraDB Free, Neo4j Enterprise features. So actually, on Aura, there are two features that are not available. One is user management, and the other one is multi-database. So you, instead of like using multi-database that you would use otherwise on a self-hosted version, you just create a new Aura instance, basically. And for user management, that's kind of part of the higher level tiers of, so it's, you have only one user, basically, to work with. Just for people to know that we set the right expectations.
Yeah, that's good. That's good to mention that. Yeah, and yeah, it makes sense, right? I mean, it's the idea is to get going with it. If you want to do user management and multi database, then you are more than starting. And then I guess that's not really the point of offering that in a free starter edition. But yes, these features are available in Neo4j Enterprise, but don't make sense in AuraDB Free.
Yeah, cool. And otherwise, I would say let's get started. So it's really an exciting topic today, and I'm really looking forward to it. Let me share my screen.
Yep.
Can you see that?
I can see that.
Okay, so we're talking today about reenacting this webinar that Nicole, our data scientist, did actually 6 years ago from 2015. And you see it has 56,000 views, almost 500 likes. So people really go back to this time and again. I thought actually it would be really nice. I mean, she did a great job there, but to pull it up basically to a recent Neo4j version and show how to do it on Aura. But otherwise, I would kind of like to keep what she's done there because the approach data model and the deload approach was pretty smart. And so from that perspective, we'll stick with her data model, which makes a lot of sense for this data. And then we go for AuraDB Free instead. So the data that she loads here is consumer complaints. So there's a data.gov consumer complaint database. And you can just download the CSV here. It's actually, if you look at it in my shell, it's 2.3 million rows. And because Aura has this limitation that Alex mentioned, I just sub-filtered it to only use November 2021, which gives us 12,000 complaints, basically. All right, so the total file is, I think, 1.4 gigabytes. But it's a little bit much for AuraDB Free, but for us, this example subset should be good enough. And I actually used XSV here just as a tip for data loading. XSV is an CSV command line tool written in Rust, which is really useful, really fast, and you can quickly compress and extract and subselect and select columns and clean up CSVs with that. So you can just install it on your system, and then it works really well. So for instance, if I do this 1.4 gigabyte subfiltering takes 1.17 seconds, basically. So it's really, really nice. And now I have my November 2021 subset in here. Cool. So much for the kind of getting this subset of the data. So I have two options on where we can load this from. Once I just put it into a GitHub gist. As such, so just you can create a new GitHub gist, drag and drop the file or upload the file into here. So that's what I have here. That's one option. One other quick option for putting data public is to just import into a Google Sheet. And then there's this in the file menu, you can do publish to the web. And then you select a tab basically not the entire document, but a tab, and then say, I want to have this as comma separated value, and then you get a link for this published thing here. So we can now access these two links, either from the GitHub.js, the raw link here, or the Google Sheet link as such. So it's in file published to the web here in this area. So if we quickly look at the CSV, what do we have in terms of data? So we have date received, when was the complaint received, what product was it about? That product are not just physical product, but also like medical products or credits or loans and things like that. Products can have sub-products. Here's the issue that popped up with this product. There might be a sub-issue and subset. Here's the text of the consumer complaint. There's a company which kind of provides this product, and there might be a public response from the company or not. State of the user, zip code. There are some tags here which we can also use that were not there in Nicole's dataset, actually. Then there's consent providers, I think, which were also not there last time. How they were submitted, I think that's almost all web, so we can probably almost ignore this. So there's one with phone, but when was it sent to the company? Did the company respond? And was the response timely? And the complaint ID. So that's kind of the data that we're looking at here from that perspective. Please shout if you have questions in general. So if you want to model this data, I go to arrows.app. Arrows.app is our quick graph modeling tool. So we can use this really quickly. And if you go there for the first time, like I've done on my new computer here, you get this really nice intro video with some keyboard shortcuts and so which you should definitely have a look at. So I'll do just done and give this graph a name, which is consumer complaints. Okay. So, and of course, our first node that we create from the data is a complaint, right? So so the complaint has an ID. So we can...
So Michael, your your resolution is a little bit blurry. Is that...
Okay.
Because you had selected a low resolution or...
I have a really high resolution. I can probably set my Mac back to standard resolution. Let me try this. One second. Display. So I have maximum resolution, basically. So this is less. Did it change something, Alex?
A little bit, but it still looks... Maybe stop sharing. Sure,
and stop sharing and reshare.
Maybe okay. that can help. Yeah.
Is this better? Any better? Or not?
A little bit. Yeah, I think that's a little bit better. Yeah.
Okay. Let us know on a stream if that's okay for you as well. Okay. So we have the complaint with the ID that we just saw in our data here at the end. And then the other thing that we have in the complaint is the date. As arrows, oops. So we have the date as well. And then we also have the complaint text as well, but we can, I think, probably also put this on the issue. So the other things that we have is kind of personal information. So we can decide if you want to put this on a separate node, like a person node, but because we don't really know the person, I would say we can just put the state and the zip code also on the complaint for the time being. If you decide to pull it out, that's always an option later on. So the other thing that we have is the complaint is for a product. So we have here, can drag out a new node on the side and say this is a product. And this complaint is about this product. And it could also be that there's a subproduct. So some of these complaints have a subproduct as well. For instance, if you have a loan or so, then a specific type of loan. And then the subproduct is in this category of this product here, right? And so the product has a name. So if you go to properties, name, which is a string, and the subproduct has as well a name, which is a string. Because this is kind of user-generated data, I'll do the same as Nicole had done back then, which is kind of to make all everything uppercase, so that we don't get any like uppercase, lowercase spelling things here. So the other thing that we have is the company. And this is kind of against this company, which kind of provides this product. The company has also a name. Oops, sorry. Let me just remove the label. Can I remove this here? So what else did we have in our... So we have date receive, we have product, we have subproduct. We have also issue and sub-issue. And then we might have a response. So let's add the issue and the sub-issue. So the complaint has an issue and potentially a sub-issue. And
just why did you put the okay.
This is a sub-issue of this issue, for instance, and complaint. What was the model that Nicole had? Let's just sneak into this. So this is about, this is with the issues and with relationship, so that we stay true to our, oh, it's also in category. Okay, this here is in category. Okay, then we also had these tags that Nicole didn't have. So we have also a tag with a name. But not many of these complaints have a tag, only a few. Oops, and the sub issue and the issue have also a name property. So, and then there might be a response from the company. So there's this basically an relationship. This is against this company. And if the company responded, there's a response for this complaint. And what did we call response to? So we basically, this arrow points currently from complaint to response. You can reverse this arrow so it points from, and this is response to this. And the company basically
answers.
Provide, yeah. Okay, answer to from response. And let's look at our data. What else do we have here? And state, zip code, tags, consumer consent. Provided, submitted via date sent to company. That's something that goes on the relationship. And company response to customer and timely response. So this is something that we can put on. So date sent to company, we can put on the relationship here. And then the timely response is something that we can either put on the response or on this relationship here.
So or we can put it in, yeah, to answered.
Mm-hmm. There was an interesting thing because Nicole had the response. Let's see. Company public response. So let's see what is heard here. Yeah. So this company public response is the text that we can put on there, but it might not be there. So we can probably use this as the type of response basically, mm-hmm. and add the additional information on the relationships. So so response text. And timely response. So response text. Text is a string. Timely is a Boolean. And then there is an disputed, right? So either there's not available or yes or no, if they disputed it or not. But it seems, at least in our data set, it almost seems everything is not available for disputed. So we can also leave it off
You can
for
ignore
all.
that then, yeah.
Okay, so we'll just remove this. Okay, so that's a pretty complex data model, right? And let's see how far we get with importing that as such. Any questions so far from anyone on the stream? Or can we get going?
I think we can get going. I think that this is, I mean, this, like you said, is a little bit more on the complex side, but I think we explained it now, and I from looking at the if you go back to the maybe to the arrows
The model.
to the model, it's from that table starting with the complaint, and that's I guess that's what we did here. We started with the complaint as the central core, and then the rest of the nodes surrounding it made sense to put them there. I guess one or the other. I mean, for example, when I read it the first time, I thought, okay, an issue has sub issue. Then why is a relationship between complaint and sub issue when the issue is kind of linked with sub issue? But I mean, that's kind of depending on the queries we wanna ask. It's not a necessity, I think, probably, but that's more like granular things,
That's
but
a good question, actually, Alex. The problem with the data is that the sub issues are not always there, just sometimes. And so there are some empty spaces here. That means we could not only link to the sub issue and then to the issue, for instance, because the issue, sub issue might not be there, right? So we need to have both, basically, the main issue, and that's kind of an subcategory as such. So because we still need to verify that this sub issue is with this complaint as well, right? If you only link to the issue, then this issue might have 20 or 50 different sub issues, and we don't know which of the 50 sub issues this complaint is correlated with, basically,
Okay.
as such. So because there's only 12,000 complaints, but there are much fewer companies, much fewer products, much fewer sub products, much fewer tags, sub issues, and responses, right? So the other node counts are much smaller because it's the same. So they kind of categorize these issues as well and the sub issues. So it's not like an individual person's text, basically, but it's more like the general, like, couldn't access the database for the loan or something like that, or the application for the loan, or things like that. So more general things. Okay, so in Neo4j Aura, actually, if you have your databases here, you can click on Create Database. And then you select database type that you want. So we want to have an ORDB free. We give it a name, for instance, consumer complaints. Select a region, for instance, in Iowa, and I want to have a blank database. And then you just click on Create Database, and it starts creating your database. You need to store the password and say, I have stored it, and then click on Continue, and then it basically is creating your database, and it takes a few minutes. That's why I already went ahead and created one that's already running for me. Okay, and
Do you want to click on that stream? Restream is showing your screen button.
oh, sorry. Cool. So, and in this Aura database, we can say open with and Neo4j browser. And if we do this, we get the connection, and then we need to log in and use the password that we had saved away somewhere here. And then we can log in.
Yeah, do not forget to save that password, because if you don't save it, nobody knows that password, and then you have to delete it and set up a new instance.
Yeah, exactly. But it's not such a big deal to drop
No,
and
it isn't.
something.
But
Except if you have all the data in there that you want to keep, then it's
yes,
it might
well
be a
then
bit
it's a different story.
more tricky.
Yeah.
Also, you could still request a backup or request a snapshot and then save the snapshot, and then you create a new database from the snapshot. So that should
It's not always lost,
still
yeah, but
work.
it's a little bit more complicated.
Okay. And so we have our browser here, and then what I want to do first is basically look a little bit at the data. So we use here load CSV with headers because our CSV file had headers, And this is the URL. This is just a short URL for our Git URL here. And S row is basically what we call each line, basically, that we get from back from the CSV. We return the first 100 rows. So return row limit 100. So you see it returns 100 rows. And then we can look at the data basically as we saw it in our CSV as well, right? So we have the complaint ID here and so on. So and now we can actually start building up our statement to import the data, right? Oh no, I forgot something. Because we want to make sure that all the data is non-duplicate in our system, we need to create a bunch of constraints here. So we say create constraint on C complaint. Assert c.id is unique, right? So that means we can't create two constraints with the same ID anymore. It would fail as such. And because each constraint also creates an automatic index, finding complaint by ID is also much faster as such. So, and because we need a bunch of other constraints as well, I'll just do this in line here. So we have the company. We have the issue, we have the sub-issue, we have the product, sub-product, tag, and the response. I forget anything? Issue, tag, sub-issue, sub-product, product, company. The company we did, right? I think I did the company. Already exists. So now we have six constraints. So we have colon schema, we can look at them. And you see here the types and what property is constraint. And then it also, the constraints are down here and the according indexes are up here as well. So we are set with for the import. Cool. So let's also have a quick look at how much data is actually in the file, if we can load it all without problems. So I just say load CSV with headers, return count star. And this gives us, gives us our 12,000 rows that we saw before in my shell, right? So that's good. So now we want to create our data.
Well, that's good enough.
Yeah. Exactly. So, and because we don't want to create duplicates, we also say we create a completion with the ID as row dot. And then the field name here, let's look at the field names, has a space in there. Here, complaint ID. So we need to escape this with backticks. So if it was just a single string, like something like zip or something like that, then we don't need to do this. But because it has a space in there, we need to do this, right? Mm-hmm. And then we set the date or date received on row dot, and it was here, date received. But because this is just a string here, or these dates are just strings, we turn it into a date type for Neo4j by just calling the date function around it, and then it creates a date for that. So the other things that we wanted to set was the zip code. This is row dot, and the state. This is the state and zip code. There, space as well. So we need to backtick it and set c dot
state
row dot state was in uppercase s, I think. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. So and if we run this and nothing is wrong, it should actually create our 12,000 complaints. Let's see. There we are. 12,000 complaints created. And if you click on complaint here, I see our complaints. And if you click on these, we can now configure what do we want to see as name here. So SIP ID state. So I can, for instance, say which state is this from or which date is this from as well. And you can also recolor them and so on. But you also see the properties of each of these complaints here as well. Right? So that worked. Good. So that's step number one. And now we want to add more data, right? So for instance, the company information here, right? So we have the complaint and we want to find and connect to the company. So basically what we now do is we do the same load CSV, but instead of merging or creating the complaint, we just find it in the database, right? So if I just want to find them and see how many complaints are found in the database, it should be also 12,000, right? So because we created all of them. So yeah. That's good. And now for the complaint, we need to create the company with the name, because we said name is the unique key. And I think it's two upper or two uppercase. Always forget this. And row dot company name or company, just company. Row dot company. And then we also create a relationship between the complaint and the company against and CEO. And then we can set on this relationship our date, where we said this is the date of date sent to company. Right. So this again finds our complaint for this current row. Then for this current row, creates a company if it doesn't exist yet with using two upper on the name. So in case we have misspellings and things like that, so it's all one. And then we create a relationship from the complaints against the company and set the relationship property date on this, right? So let's see if this works. And it created 463 companies. So we now should also see company here, and if I click on a company, we see all these companies. You can actually make them a little bit bigger. So their name is, so you see there's different bank providers, Equifax, JP Morgan, and so on, right? And we could now already do a first query that says, who are actually the companies with the most complaints, right? So we say return n dot name, comma, let's make it easier. So we have an complaint against the company. So we return n.name, comma, count star. So how many times did this against relationship exist for these companies? And then we just order by C descending limit 10 or so, right? So the top 10 companies in November 2021 that got complaints as such. And so we see it's 5,000 against Equifax and 3,500 and against TransUnion and so on. And then there's a long power tail.
Huge drop off. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. There seems to be some reason for that.
Yeah, right? Maybe.
Okay. Now we have two of our elements in there, right? So we have our company and the against relationship. And if you click on the against relationship, you also see the dates here as well. What's actually nice, if you want to, you can actually choose another something else that comes up on the relationship. So for instance, if I want to say I want to see the dates here, then I can also switch this around and show other things on this relationship, which is quite nice as well. Okay, and now we can continue. So the next things are basically very similar to what we did with the companies, right? So we find our complaint again, and instead of merging a company, we merge our issue. And I think it's just called issue. And then we have sub-issue, right? So we have issue. And create the relationships. The name for this was in with.
Do you want to keep the issue in uppercase or no?
Yeah, good point. Yeah, so let's keep this so that it's all unified stuff. And then we don't need the date property here, right? So on the issue, we didn't have anything. And the sub issue as well. So, and with the sub issues, because some of those don't exist, so they are blank, basically, right? So this is a blank sub issue here. Mm-hmm. So we want to only create sub issues that are not blank. So what we do is we say an if star where, so we can actually filter, and we say where row dot sub issue. Watch out for the spelling, because here issue has in lowercase I, typical data quality things, right? So it's not empty string, right? So we can even say that trim of sub issue is not an empty string. So even if you
need the back ticks here, because it's with a hyphen.
Yeah, because of the hyphen, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. And now we only get the rows back that have sub issues that are not an empty string. And now we basically connect our sub issue to our issue and to our complaint, basically. So, and this is issue and this is sub issue. And then we also create a relationship between the sub issue and the issue if it doesn't exist yet. Mm-hmm. And that's called in category. Right? Don't need these rel things here. So let's see. So this looks, I think, okay. What does it complain about? Ego operator. Yeah. Okay. So because we use the Swift relationship twice, it will pull in all the data at once and don't allow us to batch it into multiple transactions, but that's not relevant for this small data set. So, and with this, if we run this, actually, it finds the complaint, creates the issue if it doesn't exist, connects the complaint to the issue, filters out the sub-issues that don't have data, creates the sub-issue where it exists, if it doesn't exist yet, connects the complaint with the sub-issue, and connects the sub-issue with the issue if they are not connected yet. So if you run this, then in a few seconds, we have 181. That means a bunch of issues and a bunch of sub-issues. So we can, for instance, take one of our complaints over here. And if we expand this, we see now there's suddenly all these, the brownish ones are the sub-issues, and red ones are the issues, right? So our data is here. So let's probably should just look at one complaint. Let's just grab one complaint so it's easier. We get one complaint against a company with this issue, and the sub issue is in this category, right? And now if we wanted to, we could expand other people that have the same issue, for instance, with this company or something like that, right? Or other people that reported the same issue from the same state or something like that. So for instance, if you want to do this, you can complaint and this has an with issue. And then we want to have see how many people per state have this issue, right? And then we can say, okay, then we order by count again. And I need to spell this correctly. And if you see this, then most people in Texas and what is this, Pennsylvania, Florida, California have these issues. Right, so, okay. And on the other side, we have the products. But this looks very, very similar to what we had already. So we can just want to change something. So we can basically, instead of issue, we now do product here. Right? So p product, and this is just called product, I think, and subproduct, right? Product and subproduct.
Yeah. For lowercase p.
Exactly. So we just, and they have the same problem, right? Subproducts can be there, but don't have to be there, right? So that's kind of the problem. So, and the relationship type is about. So about product, and the subproduct is SP subproduct. So that's really nice with the completion. If you forgot, if you had an uppercase P or lowercase P, you can just press command or control space, and then it just works. About SP, and then SP is in category P, right? So this should create our right side, our left side of our graph model. Let's see how many products are there. 53, so not so many products in November. So if again we look at this one complaint and expand it, now it has not just the issue and the sub issue, but also the product and the sub product and this company, right?
So lots of complaints about one product at one company, maybe.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not a good sign.
Yeah. And then the next one is what's missing is the tags. So we saw that there are a bunch of tags as well, right? But it's also something that's optional. So this is called tags, I think. We have date received, we have product, we have subproduct, we have issue, we have sub-issue. This is the complaint text here, I think. The public response, company, the state we have covered, tags is the next one. Okay, it's just tags. And we just create a tag, t and tags. And what did I call this? Oh, nothing.
Hashtag.
Tag or something like that, right? Tag, yeah. Okay, tagged t. So this should be not so many, because you already saw in the data that there's not so many tags as such. Oh, only three, so that's really very few tags, so I'm not sure. So it's older American, interesting. Service member, I think, is this one. Service member and older American. Older American, oh, that's a comma separate. Oh, that's interesting. Oh. So we basically created, so this is actually comma separated. So that's actually a good trick to show you for the import. What we actually want to do is not just create it for text. So let me just quickly delete this text that we have. So we start over. Detach it then. So our three tags are gone. But what we actually want to do is we want to split this on comma. So you saw that there's a
multiple tags per
line, right? Yeah. So I just wanted to see if there's a space behind it after the comma. Actually, we can also look at the data ourselves. So we can just say return distinct row.tags. And then we should see this. So there's a comma space, right? Important. So what we do instead is we say split the tags. So we say unwind split row.tags. So we split the tags into by comma space as tag name. We split the tags and then turn this list that we get back here into rows. So each of these list elements would become an row. So actually, let me do this in two steps. If we return row.tags as tag name, and then, oh no, that's Text name. So if you just want to see this, then it would be either a list with one element for these two or a list with two element elements here. Right? And this list we turn into rows. Instead of returning this list, we do an unwind. So each of these elements becomes a row, and then we use tag name instead of here. So we could also save the to upper here because you have only three, but just from consistency perspective. Right. And if we do this, we get our three. No, actually, now we get only two tags because we have only service member and old American. It's a really interesting way of tagging. I mean, service member, I can understand if there's some veteran-related things, but old American is kind of interesting that they have only two tags. Yeah. Anyway. Cool. And jetzt ist now the interesting thing is the response, right? We said if there's a response to our complaint, then we also want to record this. So that means we need to go back to our thing here. So we find our complaint. We also want to find our company, actually. You want to connect the company to, it was just company, right? Company. And then we want to have this complaint company response sent to consumer. That's our cell that we want to look at. And this is what we call response. Right. And then our relationship type was from response to complaint. That's a good point. So we have to flip the directional arrow here. So the response has a complaint, and we have from company, what did we say, answered or something like that, right, Alex?
I think so, yeah. Yeah.
Answered, and that's our response. And then the other thing that we had, we wanted to store stuff on the response, the text, and if it was timely. Right. So one simple thing is the timely bit. You see here there's yes, there's also no and blanks. So we only want to say this is timely when it was and yes. Mm-hmm. So we just say set.
So you don't want to save the no's?
No, it's automatically false. Basically what we say is timely response. Even including question mark.
Including, exactly. So forget the question
mark. Okay. getting interesting. This is equal to yes. Right? Then it sets it either to true or false, basically. Right? So it compares the timely response field with yes. And if it's yes, then this is true. And otherwise, it's false. And that's what ends up on our timely. And rel.text. So we need to find out where the text was. Consent, company public response, this one. I love this data stuff. Right, and because it's a text, case when. So let's see, it set this only when it actually exists and not when it's empty. When it's empty, then we want to set it to null, else row dot. We check when this is an empty string, then we just don't want to write anything. We just set null on the text, which removes it again. And then otherwise, we set the response itself. And we sent this, and I think there was no date for the response, right? Or did I miss this? This is the date when it got sent to the company, but no date when the company actually responded. Such.
Don't think I saw that.
No. Okay, cool. And so if you run this, there's nothing wrong. This is not a programming language, so it's only a simple equal sign. So, and we had four. Oh, that's interesting. There are only four types of company responses.
Really?
I would not have expected that. I thought there would be more types of responses. Okay, closed with monetary relief, closed with non-monetary relief, closed with explanation, and in progress. Oh, interesting. Okay.
That's kind of makes sense. But that's more like a
state or so,
state,
right? So
it's yeah, not, really, yeah.
Right. Yeah. And that's why I think if you look at one of our complaints again, let's take just one and see what's the response. That's why on the relationship between this we have the timely and the text when it has a text, right? So let's see if we find one that has a text. Where r dot text not. We need to disable connect result nodes because otherwise it will automatically connect our stuff. They have all text response. Interesting. Company has responded to the customer and the CFPB and chose not to provide a public. Okay, that's not a public response. Okay, so it's only a private response, basically. Interesting. Okay, and that's kind of our data model now, right? So if you look at this and call db dot schema visualization, this is basically what we have here.
You forgot to give the tags or relationship to the.
I thought I had given them one because you have tagged here, but there might be an issue with this.
Or are these the old tags? Maybe they're still as a label.
Oh yeah, that could be yeah. Because I have our two tags, and I thought,
Okay.
Oh, I might have made a mistake there. That's actually a good point. Let's go back to those. So we probably get rid of the tags for the time being again. And then if you use history, then you see your past statements, and then we can find our tags. Here is our tag, and oh, I see. So the problem is when you use with and you don't pass along stuff from before, it gets lost. So you need to pass along the things that you want to have. So for instance, our complaint needs to be passed along in this place, and if it doesn't, then it creates a new node for that. That's the problem. So, but this is our tag name. This is our complaint now. Okay, now it should actually work. Oops. Okay. So, and if we now look at our tags, it should have many more. Yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay, perfect. Yeah.
So, good point. So, we found actually an issue with our statement call db method visualization. And now the text is also
now
connected.
Nice.
Right, and now we can basically draw a model like we had it.
In arrows before. Just before. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Right. So in this in category, I think is wrong. That doesn't really exist. From subproduct to that's actually an artifact. That's not correct. Okay, so because if you call epoch meta graph, then they should not show up. Let's see. Yep. Right. So, and that kind of inputs our data. Now we can do lots of fun queries. So we can look at like distribution from companies. We can see what are repeated issues with product. Are people from the same zip code have issues? Are there basically the same kind of responses for the same product and things like that? So we can do all kinds of fun queries of that. Perhaps you can do the last one before you run out of time.
Yeah, do one now, and then maybe we do another session next week or something on now that we have established the model. I think it would be nice to do a one or two queries on it.
So this is our complaint, product, and response, and we wanted to say how frequently are basic responses for the same product happening, right? So we can basically say product.name. We ignore actually the complaint because the actual complaint is not so interesting for us, only the count. Mm-hmm. And the response name and count star order by count sending limit 10. You see that in progress is very frequent and closed with explanation is second most frequent, and then it tapers off again, right?
Yeah.
We could also do things like, okay, how often did this response occur in total, basically, and then say, what's the percentage of responses that have this this product has this as such, right? So we can say for and we can just say how many times did this response. So if you put out count or response count. So that's the total number of responses with this. And we just match this again and then say we can also have a percentage count. So which is basically to float of C because you need a floating point by R count. Or we say C times 100, so we get the percentage as 100, right? As percent.
I think you need a
sorry, because I see here twice, so we don't values. Oh, okay. Plus. Okay, and then we see that's not correct.
No.
That's very much not correct. What's the problem? Our response, r.name. What's the total count? So, of course, we need to measure here how often did the response not exist in general, but how often did the occur in. In regard to a product, to another, a complaint, right? So we basically need to do our count and then it could be that it actually let's see. Yeah, so 93% for this kind of product are in progress, basically, right? So it's very dissatisfactory for 93% of the people that raise the complaint that this is not, right? No. There for other products, like debt collection in progress is only 2%, right? So that's that's an interesting, so I guess that's where people or institutions want to get money. They are more likely to kind of finish these complaints, and whereas in other cases they're not as likely to do that. So we could also order not by C but by the percent. So we see the ones that have high percentages on top, even if the counts are quite low. Right, so that's also, we can also look at this as well. Cool, and that I think concludes this session, and I hope we did it justice and Nicole's video. So let's see if our video gets as many views as Nicole's.
Maybe, yeah, we can. We can definitely, I mean, either we explore it some more next week or if you have any questions, type it in, let us know, reach out.
Yeah.
And then we can dig some more into it.
Yeah. And I'll write up a blog post again and share it over the course of the week. And then like the last few ones we did actually also turn into a blog post. So if you go to our developer blog, you can see, where is it actually? Somewhere down here.
You'll find it definitely on our developer blog and then also in the YouTube video description where there is all this information in the description below. You can click on that link. I will add that afterwards.
So we have all the information and so from that perspective. You can follow that along in the blog post as well. Cool. Sounds good.
Okay.
Thank you all.
All right. Thank you, Michael. Thank you for taking the time again to lead us through. Thank you all for joining. Thank you for watching and commenting. And I hope you enjoyed the session. And we'll be back next week. And wish you all a good time and see you soon.
Take care, everyone.
Take care. Bye-bye.